Extra Life, Chapter 1, Res.
Tears?
Kamakura Izuru's fingers brushed the warm liquid running down his cheeks, surprise coloring the motion. He half expected them to disappear at his touch, foreign as they were, but they remained, blurring his vision, obscuring the hairpin, and the blood and the body of Nanami Chiaki. As he thought her name, snippets of conversations. Galaga Omega, right? New game came out. Talent. More than the ultimate gamer. Flooded his brain so fast it left him dizzy. Flashes of a fountain and a gaming console and the same girl before him. Memories? Impossible. His past self was dead. But he was remembering things that hadn't happened to him, seeing Nanami's smiling face and feeling his chest flood with warmth. And now he was looking at her body, and he was... His breath hitched sharply. Someone had taken a knife and carved a hole into his chest, while someone else had taken a hammer and driven a nail into his head. That was what these feelings were. Grief. Hysteria. Confusion. Logic supplied, and Izuru felt his hands tremble. He'd known what they were called, but he'd never experienced anything like them before, and it was throwing him off guard. There was too much happening, too many things spinning around, and for once in his life, he couldn't make heads or tails of it. But even while part of his mind was distraught, overwhelmed by emotions and trying to understand what was happening to him, the other part was coolly analyzing the situation, examining Nanami's body with clinical efficiency. As if in a trance, he crouched, ignoring the blood seeping into his pants, and reached for her wrist. He noted her fading pulse, clammy skin, and bluing fingertips. Combined with her earlier pale complexion, dizzy confusion, and of course heavy blood loss, the diagnosis was most likely Class 4 hypovolemic shock caused by massive exsanguination. Patient has lost consciousness and will be dead in minutes without treatment. Necessary steps: establishing airway debris, applying pressure to wounds to stem further blood flow. Replenishing intravascular volume, administering antibiotics to prevent septic shock and infection. Patient will be dead in minutes without treatment. Nanami Chiaki will be dead in minutes without treatment. Nanami Chiaki will be... Before he could even comprehend why he was doing so, Izuru found himself yanking off his blazer. His eyes ran over Nanami's still form, pinpointing the most serious injuries as his hands tore the material into strips. Three penetrating wounds in her abdominal area, multiple penetrating wounds and cuts on her arms and legs. One penetrating wound in her foot, one laceration on her forehead. It only took a few seconds to establish a patient airway by rolling her over, lifting her chin, and opening her mouth. Then Izuru tore off her jacket, blouse, and bra in one clean motion, paying no heed to her bare breasts. Mindlessly, he wrapped the makeshift bandages tightly around her injuries, hands moving at a blur. Only one thought, one he couldn't even understand the reason behind, rang through his mind. He could not allow her to die. Hypovolemic shock was reversible if treated swiftly enough. Contrary to popular belief, one's brain did not shut down immediately upon experiencing traumatic injuries of this manner. There was a small window, the span of minutes, where it sluggishly slowed due to a lack of oxygen as blood failed to travel to it. Slowed, but not stopped, and if quick enough medical action was taken, death could be warded off. 3 minutes. He had 3 minutes to treat her shock before her organs started taking damage. Each minute after that steadily increased the odds of permanent organic or neurological damage. With the amount of blood she'd lost, he suspected she would last no longer than 10 minutes before dying. No, he probably had less than 3 minutes. How much time had he wasted, lost in his confused days? No more than seconds, he suspected, but everyone counted. Unknown to most, Hope's Peak Academy had an extensive underground complex that ran beneath the entire campus. Izuru had spent most of his existence down there, first by order of the steering committee, then by order of Enoshima, to keep himself a secret from the academy. He'd long since memorized the web of tunnels and rooms. The one they were currently in wasn't too far from the rooms he'd been kept in as the steering committee tested him, the rooms that had the equipment that just might permit him to save her. He bent and scooped Nanami into his arms in a macabre parody of a bridal carry. In normal circumstances, someone in her condition should either be moved via flat surface like a stretcher or not moved at all, but Izuru didn't have a stretcher on hand, and it would be far too time-consuming to fetch the apparatus to save her and bring them back. Trying to jostle her as little as possible, he set off down the hall at a sprint. The part of the complex he'd been held in was Spartan, made up of just the lab where he'd been quote-unquote born, a storage room that held food and other necessities, a clinic, and the room he'd stayed in when he wasn't being tested. He could scarcely call it a bedroom. The clinic was there mostly in case something happened to him during his transformation or during testing, and was stocked with anything related to medical care, from band-aids to vaccines to surgical equipment. It was this room Izuru arrived at 10 seconds later, kicking the door open and laying Nanami down on the first cot he saw. Izuru's hand snapped over to the thermostat on the wall, raising it to warm Nanami before she experienced hypothermia. He slid several pillows under her legs to elevate them, so blood would have an easier time flowing back to her heart. Now, assess and prioritize. Replenishing her blood volume was the next step. He reached into a cabinet and began pulling down the equipment for a blood transfusion. With the amount she'd lost, she'll need multiple transfusions. What's her blood type? His hands paused for a few seconds as he realized he didn't know. He could have transfused some of his own blood into her body, but his blood type was A, not O, the universal donor. If she were an A or an AB, she would be fine if she took his blood. If she were a B or an O, she would definitely die. 50% odds were unacceptable. So Izuru went for the second option, blood substitutes. An academy full of as many talented people as Hope's Peak Academy would naturally lead in many fields, including science, and over the years had created successful solutions that stimulated the properties of real blood. They were no long-term replacement, but they were suitable for usage in emergency trauma situations, such as this one. There were several packets also in this lab, and Izuru grabbed one and returned to Nanami's side. Swiftly, he attached it to an IV and injected it into a vein along her elbow. As the IV fed the artificial blood into her body, he quickly fetched a crystalloid solution that would increase circulatory volume, helping the precious oxygen flow. This too was intravenously inserted into Nanami's unconscious form. Next, Izuru checked pulse and blood pressure again, swiftly hooking her up to a digital monitor. His eyes narrowed minutely when he noted they were fluttering, fading. He administered a dose of norepinephrine to increase blood pressure and aid her heart's pumping. Almost impatiently, he stared at the monitor, waiting for the readings. Only when it informed him that her vitals were weak, but holding, did he relax. He glanced at the clock to see he'd made it under the 3-minute time limit, with seconds to spare. Good. There was always the risk of complications creating brain damage, but this gave her the highest chance of full cognitive recovery. He paused long enough to catch his breath and run over what needed to be done next. Internal bleeding. He needed to check for internal bleeding and perform surgery if there was. The black-haired man dragged over the machine for a CAT scan and flipped it on. Within a few moments, it returned the results. 2 torn organs. Pausing only long enough to tie his hair out of his face, Izuru snapped on a surgical mask and the corresponding gloves and went to work. The 2 consecutive surgeries took over 6 hours, and by the time he was done, the artificial ultimate hope was out of breath and up to his elbows in blood. His blazer was torn to shreds, his shirt and tie were blood-soaked and ruined beyond repair, his pants were only in slightly better condition, and he looked more rumpled than he could remember ever possibly being. But he was successful, and his stitches as he closed the surgical incisions were neat and precise. He felt drained as he went through the final stages of the treatment, giving Nanami a dosage of antibiotics to prevent septic shock and checking her vitals again. They were within acceptable parameters now. As he now had access to proper gauze, he swapped out her bandages. And that was that. He was now gazing down at a weak, but alive, Nanami Chiaki.